least 25% of the admissions to hospital are as a result or side effect of drugs. This was taught to me even in medical school. But the reasons for this are not really properly explained and don't seem to be properly understood. In medical school, pharmacology is examined by multiple choice exam. This is a major problem. Multiple choice exams just require people to guess, and if they don't give what is called the right answer, then they won't pass their exam. In other words, they repeat what they're told. When you graduate at the end of your medical training, if you haven't been taught anything about mental relaxation and you're not mentally relaxed yourself, if you haven't been taught about communication and you don't communicate well yourself, you have very little chance of learning it through the style of medicine that is taught in medical schools in Australia. You are taught not to get too involved with your patients. In other words, you don't really get to know them. You fob off problems, and you also get motivated by fear of litigation. And as a result of it, you investigate and you refer. The specialists do exactly the same thing, except in a more extreme situation, because they feel the buck stops there, and therefore they must investigate fully. This means spending thousands of dollars on investigations for conditions that they really know that the patient doesn't have. The other side of this is that problems, side effects, and iatrogenic problems are denied because they're afraid that patients will sue. This comes from a paranoia that is engendered by various medical defense societies which send doctors various examples of negligence cases in America and England, which make doctors in Australia afraid that they'll get sued for the same reasons. The problem with being motivated by being sued is, or fear of being sued, is that doctors stop being honest with their patients. They stop being honest about what they don't know. They stop being honest about the side effects of drugs because they don't really have any other cards up their sleeve in terms of treating patients other than prescribing drugs. I know this because this is what happened to me when I was working in general practice. If a patient was stressed or anxious, I didn't really know what to do apart from listen to them. And if that didn't help, give them drugs. And very often that's really what the patient was there for. They were expecting drugs, they wanted drugs, and they had been convinced that drugs would be the answer to whatever problem they had. This is no coincidence, because that idea is actively propagated by the medical establishment and has been for many, many years. The most outrageous example of this that I have found recently is a book called Beyond Prozac. Beyond Prozac is written by Michael J. Norton and published by HarperCollins. And its back cover is drug advertising at its worst. Now revised and expanded to include the latest new information and research, Beyond Prozac gives you the inside scoop on powerful new antidepressants, Ferzone, Wellbutrin, and Remeron. The surprising relationship between weather, brain chemistry, and behavior. New studies hinting that low serotonin is the norm, not the exception, and what this really means to those seeking treatment. What melatonin really can and can't do. Depression, health, and the zone diet. The latest all-natural treatments for depression, DHEA and St. John's wort. Updates on Prozac, Zoloft, Paxil, Luvox, and more. I found this book in the local Richmond library, and it was there under a series of books on health generally, including mental health. And the book is unabashed advertising for the new antidepressants. But it's remarkable for another point, and this is to do with the pineal. Chapter 5 is called Melatonin, the Natural Heir to Serotonin. It starts, "When I was preparing the original edition of this book, I was concerned that few readers would have heard of melatonin. Over the past year, I suspect few have escaped hearing about it. Unfortunately, most of what was said tended to overstate the case in one direction or the other. Proponents often presented it as a cure-all, and critics conveniently ignored the strongest evidence in support of its benefits. We'll explore the evidence pro and con, but first let's take a deeper look at this vital neurohormone. In recent years, scientists have discovered how, often in tandem with its parent serotonin, melatonin exerts its considerable influence over the entire body. Melatonin helps us adapt to basic environmental rhythms such as day and night, bringing home the message that night has fallen and signaling the start of various mental and physical restorative processes. Without melatonin, these critical processes would fall out of sync with our periods of activity and rest. It also likely accounts for almost half of the body's temperature rhythm, producing much of the nighttime temperature drop required for sleep. Melatonin is often confused with melanin, which produces the darkness of the skin and is essentially unrelated. Melatonin enters any cell easily and is able to pass through the so-called blood-brain barrier that stops serotonin and many medications cold. Thus, as is not the case with serotonin, we can boost brain levels simply by taking a melatonin pill. People have already started using melatonin to advantage, from battling cancer to simply getting a good night's sleep. Perhaps not surprisingly, modern living may be hard on melatonin. Exposure to electromagnetic fields seems to disrupt melatonin rhythms. Thus, living to high voltage power lines may be hazardous. The risk, however, appears quite small."